I call this meeting to order. It's 4 o'clock. Normal chairperson, Councilman Weed, is not available, so I'm acting in his presence.
Is that like the abnormal chairperson?
Yeah, we'll do that.
Dennis.
Dennis has called it.
He's on the phone?
Dennis, are you there?
Dennis is in the house.
Yes, I am. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, Dennis. Welcome.
Well, thank you. Good to be back in the meeting, sort of.
Sort of. How are you feeling?
I'm actually feeling pretty good. It's bad news is I thought I was getting out of here Saturday. That's not the case. I think I'll be here for at least a week and maybe a couple of weeks more. Good news is I got to switch. They switched my room, so I have a perfect view of Pikes Peak to the west.
Oh,
and
excellent.
All the mountains of the Front Range. So could be worse.
Good. You have an agenda?
I do, yes.
Okay, we're gonna start out with item number one. So Terry, floor is yours.
Thank you, council members. We are gonna talk about aesthetics, and primarily the aesthetics of the Highway 50 corridor, although we'll be talking about some other things too. Mr. O'Rourke and I have talked about this for some time, as we've talked about increasing our code enforcement regulations and also our patrols. We have a new code enforcement officer. And we're looking at some of the aesthetic qualities along the Highway 50 corridor. I handed out a handout to you, and there's some extra ones for members of the audience up there on the table if you wanted to get that. So we're primarily going to be talking about the Highway 50 corridor all the way through town. And it was my estimation that we probably should be speaking about all of those destinations where a lot of our visitors go. And so during this, I identified the Skyline Drive and the Floral Avenue Trailhead, so all of 5th Street all the way up, Centennial Park and all the way around Centennial Park on Griffin and other places that should be really pristine as we welcome our guests. The Prison Museum, for instance, that draws a lot of visitors during the summer. Canyon City High School, where there are many events that are hosted by Canyon City High School, and we welcome visitors there, as well as Tunnel Drive Trailhead. So that's basically the area of focus. Let me start out by showing you some things that I noticed along the Highway 50 corridor. And I did call this the good, the bad, and the ugly. And we do have, I will have to say, we have some really lovely bright spots along the corridor. We have some places that are very nicely landscaped. You'll see that on the left. Public art, the dinosaur in front of the museum is a high point along Highway 50. I'm sorry, let me I think I'm using the wrong thing. Am I, Elijah? Can I just go? There we go. So we do have landscaping, and things are well maintained and inviting in certain places along the corridor. And then we have this. I did an inventory, and of course I've told everyone in City Hall who will listen to me, I did an inventory all the way through town on Highway 50, and I counted 99 dumpsters that I could see from as I was driving. There are 57 on the north side of the highway and 40 some odd on the south side of the highway. And unfortunately, this doesn't show our community in the best light. Dumpsters in the right of way, dumpsters just out and about, and these are probably three of the most visible ones. And there are more.
It could also mean that we're very clean people who like to throw stuff out.
That's true.
Sure. I just want to interject that because heaven knows we don't like rules.
I know.
Go ahead.
It's important to dispose of our trash, but it isn't necessarily in the that everyone can see where our trash is. So we can have the, we can be showing those, or would it be better? Am I doing this wrong?
That'll work.
Okay. Would you rather see what's on the left, or would you rather see what's on the right? Now, new site plans require trash enclosures like that on the right. And what
can I ask a silly question, Terry?
Of course.
Rather than building enclosures, why don't we paint the dumpsters the same color as the building they're sitting next to?
Well, I guess if they were owned outright, that might be a possibility, but those are provided by the...
I'm aware of that, but it's like, wouldn't that take care of it with probably a minuscule amount of money in construction and such?
Well, we have some...
I mean, not the only solution, but a solution.
I guess that's possible. I guess that would be up to the two trash haulers if they really wanted to have their dumpsters be painted.
I don't think I can't speak for them, but it kind of makes certain sense.
I can't either, so I'm not sure. But be that as it may, it probably is a good idea, if at all possible, for these to be enclosed somehow. It's more attractive. And if we could get as many as we possibly can to be enclosed or stored in an unobtrusive location, all the better for removing clutter from the corridor. Second item is outdoor storage. There are, and this is particularly along East Main, where the backs of buildings are visible to the Highway 50 corridor. A lot of folks are storing things back behind their buildings. If we had some screening regulations that required them to either store things inside their buildings or to screen it, then these kinds of situations wouldn't be seen from the highway. It would make it more attractive. And then we've got signs. We have signs all through the corridor. Signs are ubiquitous with commercial activity, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with them. Our sign code was written in 1991, and it really does need to be revised. Tony and I were talking today about a particular sign application that came in, and it was difficult to interpret because our sign code is not in the best form it could be. It needs to be updated. There are a lot of new types of signage. Signage does not necessarily, in a corridor like this, have to be very tall any longer. It can be shorter, more compact. We just went through a comprehensive sign plan amendment last year, which also helps people consolidate signage so there doesn't have to be so much. That also contributes to clutter. It makes things actually harder to see rather than easier to see. So the first thing that we will do, at least in the sign code, is to bring forward a revision that's based on the Reed versus Gilbert Supreme Court case that is an absolute must that we must resolve. It basically states that if you regulate a sign based on what it actually says, then you're probably not complying with the law as it is now. So that will be our first thing. And then we will also try to improve upon our signage and make recommendations, whether that involves some public process or not, that would entirely be up to you, and see if we can't consolidate some of our signage. We would also be, let me go through this and show you a couple of other things. We have a lot of banners. When I went out, and there is actually one business that has 8 banners in front of and on the side of their business. That's probably excessive. And we may want to, we actually have a banner code that says that you have to get a permit for a banner. There have been so many in the past that, and the fee for it is so minimal that it simply has never been enforced. And it probably needs to be enforced and can be also rewritten in a new sign code so that it's much easier. It's easier for the staff with its limited resources to enforce. And also we just simply need to get all of our business owners to understand it better and make it easier for them to apply for something like that if that's what comes to be. Some other examples of signage. Sign on the right is a non-conforming sign. It's higher than 25 feet. The Jimmy John's sign is actually, if on the left, is 25 feet. And the McDonald's sign behind it is non-conforming. It's much higher, even though it certainly doesn't look at it. It is much higher than 25 feet. And the sign at the bottom of the right, on the right, which is one of those very old style movable signs, is in non-conforming as well, as I do believe it's inside the setback. Generally, the signs
Yes, sir. Yeah, do you want comments as you go along, or you just kind of want to hold off until you get done?
I don't have too many more left. Can we wait?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So the other, here's some other signage that we see fairly often, especially like at the hardware stores where they'll put signage actually on their product. That's not necessarily a bad thing. I don't know what Ellets are, but sold the P sign.
Baby chickens, I think.
One of the other things that we have a problem with, I do believe, is old sign structures that are no longer valid. They have basically been abandoned. We need to improve our sign code so that those things can be removed after a certain amount of time. There are quite a few along the corridor. The more that we are able to remove that kind of signage, the less clutter that we will have. And it's cumulative. We also have sandwich boards. I would be my recommendation to not allow them on Highway 50. As we do this, though, I also think it's very important because businesses on Main Street and elsewhere want to have that exposure. And the idea in the Highway 50 corridor plan was to give them wayfinding. And I think it's going to be very important as we eliminate this kind of signage that we have appropriate signage at each intersection along downtown directing people to these places. Not necessarily specifically them. I mean, it could be that our wayfinding can accommodate that, but at least to tell people that there's dining and there are museums and galleries and restaurants to visit. So that they don't feel that they have to put something in the right of way that falls off the sidewalk and really is not very attractive. So, something else that we need to address in the sign code. Another example of abandoned sign structures. And then we talk about just general aesthetics, maintenance. These are two structures that are on Highway 50. Right in the Royal Gorge area, and they are relatively unkempt. Fencing that needs to be painted, roof that obviously needs to have to be repaired, and a shop that needs probably to be painted as well. Doesn't look very inviting. Another one along the sidewalk, not very inviting, nor is the structure. And then there's some general maintenance that I found kind of This, actually on the left, this is a mansard roof at the Safeway. It actually needs to be painted. We have a major employer who is major business that we want to have here, and we want them to have the pride in their community, just like the local locksmith. And of course, there's this particular issue on Highway 50, which is, I'm not sure how that's going to be resolved, but eventually, let's hope that that gets fixed as well. So, how do we get to this built environment and these from where we are right now? We have some of this, and I do believe that the ones that I've just showed you detract from the beauty that we do have in our natural environment, and also those places that are actually quite attractive. So that's my presentation. And if you have, I'm just going to go through, if it's okay, Dennis, I'm just going to go through a couple of things that I kind of to wrap up. In terms of helping with the, in terms of addressing the dumpsters, there was a trash ordinance back in 2009 that did not pass. And we're bringing that back with some changes to it that would require dumpsters to either be stored in an unobtrusive location or to be screened. And they could be screened by any number of different ways, and that would be in the regulations. It would also address business dumpsters in residential areas and also construction dumpsters. And they would be, construction dumpsters now would be required to have permits that the code enforcement officer would do. Then we're also considering bringing forward screening requirements, very possibly, if that's something that you think would help with outdoor storage. And then also working on our sign code, where we would probably disallow sandwich boards. We would kind of beef up our regulations about abandoned signs and that kind of thing. Now, as I said, these things are cumulative. As we reduce clutter and improve some of those things that we can, our corridor is going to look nicer over time, and hopefully soon.
Terry, sorry. The dumpster issue is also for the residential area?
Yes,
the screening or unobtrusive area?
Mm-hmm.
Because I've had several calls on that in several neighborhoods.
Right.
I'm plagued with it.
The suggestion is, and this came back in 2009, this isn't new, the business dumpster is the small dumpster, not the big construction dumpster. So it's a small dumpster. And those would not be allowed in residential areas at single family homes or duplexes. You would use a 96 gallon tote. You know what the tote looks like. It has that big,
actually sits behind your gator,
right,
in your garage.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's more appropriate for a single family home. Not that you couldn't have one of the business dumpsters if you wanted it for a special project or whatever. That would be certainly allowable.
But everyday usage of one and having it sit out is okay.
Not at a single family home. Because there are quite a few of them, and they end up on the sidewalks and in the street. And people don't move them, so. And there shouldn't be those things in the streets or on sidewalks.
Lisa? Quickly.
We're in a rural farming area. We have to realize that we do have some hobby farms here where we have single family homes that have horses, and they can't store the manure. And what they do is they rent a dumpster, and the manure goes into the dumpster. That's a single family home, and they can't put them in the 96 gallon totes. So you do have to consider the higher, I mean, you don't want manure building up on a property either. So things to consider.
Are you in the city limits? Are you talking about people in the city limits? It's just for the city.
Within the city limits, you have people that have horses, yes.
Good.
Absolutely,
no.
You do.
Good.
Okay. I didn't know that. I learn something every day. Dennis, did you want to say something?
Yeah, I had a couple of comments. Terry, you didn't mention anything about the pod signs, and I'm guessing those are acceptable in their current format. I think they're relatively uniform. That, you know, the tourist-oriented directional signs, the pod signs, you know.
The blue ones? Yes. I think the Highway 50 corridor plan actually suggests that some of that signage be combined. So we would be looking at that as we go through the corridor and try to do some of that. But yes, they are.
Okay. And then, where I would really like to see this go, and I don't know if this is a possibility, and what's the concept or how you would bring it about, but get some kind of a more uniform sign code for the Highway 50 corridor or any of the important corridors that we identify. But, you know, if you go up into some of the mountain towns and if you go up to Breckenridge or Steamboat or Vail or Aspen, they have pretty strict sign codes about, you know, so there's a certain uniformity that they have their signs. And so you don't get this crazy random variety of signs that we have at Canyon. And so, I'd like to see if there isn't a way that we could get a somewhat more uniform sign code instead of this just mishmash of stuff we have. And, you know, and so obviously there's going to be a cost to business people. And I'm one of them, so I would be affected by this as well. But an interesting example is I have a business in Idaho Springs, and they're redoing one of the main roads through town that our business happens to be on. And as a result of widening and redoing the road, we have a rather large sign that's going to need to move, and the city has made a couple of offers, and then, you know, maybe this is something that we could look at instituting, to the city of Idaho Springs, that said they will pay to remove the sign, the existing sign, which in the case of this one that we have is would be a significant cost, but they would pay to remove it. They'll also waive sign fees building permit fees when you build a new sign, as long as the new signs are built to the new sign code. So I don't know if there's a way to incorporate a more uniform, well, that's what I'd like to see, a kind of a uniform sign code, whether, you know, it's like all the signs on the Highway 50 corridor have to have wood frames or, you know, whatever, or stone frames, or but I'd like to see that. And then I don't know how you make people do that, or if you can, and that might be a question for Catherine, whether you can legislate and say, okay, you've got this much time to make your signs now meet this new sign code.
Well,
I'm actually on the phone as well. Sorry,
do you want to go ahead and answer that part of?
Yeah, sure.
And then I can talk about incentives.
So signs are like any kind of zoning regulation. You can't require people to come into conformity by a certain period of time, which is called amortization. So you're prohibited from doing that. And so, like Terry mentioned earlier, this would be a lot of what she's talking about would be over a period of time where, you know, a new business comes in and they need a sign permit, and we would make them, you know, fix the sign to be conforming to the extent we can. So it would be over a period of time that we would shift things to match a new sign code that we would implement.
Well, that having been said, however, Dennis, there are communities, just like you mentioned in Idaho Springs, that can incentivize some of this to progress faster than it would normally. Tony and I have talked, once you start that process in a community, and it kind of tends to take on a motivation in and of itself, and when several signs are done, they're attractive. Other businesses see how nice this looks. They might want to participate too. And of course, as we go through this, we could offer incentives as well. And that makes sense in order to make it go faster. Otherwise, you do. You'll have to wait until the sign either falls down or the business goes away, and then a non-conforming sign can be changed.
And that's what I don't know where we get the money for it, but that's really what I'm thinking is significant incentives to encourage people to build signs to a somewhat more uniform standard. So you don't get this trashy look when you drive through town, everything from banners to billboards to sandwich boards. So, I mean, we've got it all.
Yes, and I would say that if and when we take on this sign code issue and start to make some of these changes, that would be an appropriate thing to do. If we want to actually affect a change in a reasonable amount of time, we would have to do that.
Well, that was discussed years ago when I was on Planning Commission, that the city would be involved in that process to change it, and that didn't meet well, because heaven knows we don't like regulations here. And but the city was contemplating incentivizing by taking down signs, offering some architectural help, design help, I guess you would call that, from a city engineer, and actually some grants of out-and-out money to do things. I think in this day and age, to put some humor in this, we'll have to have a catch and release clause in there too, which goes like this. It's a new legal jargon. If we catch you doing it and you've done it for more than 2 years, we release you. Sorry.
Mr. Gill, any comments?
I made mine.
I think I'd be strongly in favor of an incentive program. I like that idea. I think that would be worth an investment to motivate people to do that at their own volition. I also wonder if we also shouldn't have a meeting with business owners along the Highway 50 corridor, educational one, about the strategic planning, ultimate goals of Canyon City moving forward, and where we want to see our future, and how they can be an important part of that future, and that they can also be a part of the decision making, and so that they can be a part of the agreement of what needs to be done there, and so that not only can have their support, they're not blindsided, and also hopefully among their peers that they'll be that they'll back up the city in some of these decisions that we may or may not make depending on their feedback, and also maybe find what the best incentive would be that they would be the best lure for them.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think, go ahead, Mark.
In this thing, in order to go forward, and I think probably the first step that needs to be made in this is to decide what kind of incentive program we would like to offer. The sooner we get that incentive program together, the faster this will move along. So it's like step one. Find out what we can do, what other cities have done, and what we're able to do to move this forward. I think that's very important, so that you can go out and reasonably talk to people and say, okay, this is the plan, rather than saying, okay, we're going to change the sign code. Well, we're going to do some kind of incentive, which has happened, and quite frankly, it doesn't leave a good taste. So I don't know how we would go about figuring out what kind of incentive program to offer as a square one, and a lot of people might do it voluntarily without a whole lot of work because they want to upgrade their avenue of retail and the way that they do business. And then also that would lead people that really don't care to maybe come into conforming because of the pressure of their peers in creating a desirable drive down Highway 50.
And Terry?
Sorry. Go ahead.
I was just going to add one more thing, a possibility to consider Mountain View Park as one of your, it's not a big destination point, but that's where the kids traveling soccer blitz teams are. And we have 20 to 60 families every Saturday that come from all over Denver and Wyoming and surrounding areas. And a lot of times I'm so embarrassed by the weeds, the junk cars, and just it's definitely not showing Canyon City's finest.
Okay, I'll definitely add it. We'll
Well, don't you also audit? I don't know if the incentivization comes first. I think overall review of designs comes first. I have a business on Royal Gorge Boulevard. I'd like to see what you have in mind. I mean, what is the design? We're talking wood, we're talking stone, we're talking brick, stucco. What do you have in mind? What's it going to look like? And, you know, if it's a nice image, then I might just go ahead and do it. But to say I'm going to incentivize it without knowing where we're going with that, what it's going to look like, what the cost might be, it's cool, but I have nothing to go on.
Maybe I was misunderstood.
Okay.
We need to know what the program is.
Yeah.
And maybe I didn't follow through. It's okay, but this is why conversations are had. Figure out the incentive, or like you say, figure out the design first and find out what the financial impact is going to be, and then create an incentive program based on that.
Yeah,
so
that makes sense. Yeah, what's it going to look like? I'm restricted by what Cobalt Banker will let me do.
Right.
So.
Well, and that gets us to the decision. Go ahead, Dennis.
Okay. So I was going to say, the way I look at this is we're going to be working on this Highway 50 corridor plan, and that's going to, presumably, it's going to have some kind of a unified theme for what the corridor is going to look like. And I think our sign code through the corridor ought to be modeled off of what the Highway 50 corridor plan is kind of proposing as the look that we're trying to present, you know. So if it's stone and wood signs, then that's what we do. If it's hand-painted plywood, well, then that's what we do. But you know, I don't think it's just a random shot in the dark. This is what we want signs for. I think it all needs to be coordinated so that you get this one kind of themed look as you go through town from east to west or the other way. I think do the corridor plan, and then from that work out what you think these signs ought to look like if you want to try and attempt it at all.
I think that's a good idea, Dennis.
One of the things, I guess my concern would be that we're in a really challenging time right now, and we're talking about imposing some additional regulations on businesses, and I just question how much input we've got from those businesses. It would seem to me like that it would make sense that we're having some success with some community committees, that we get a group together that involves some Highway 50 businesses and has some downtown businesses and businesses that are in these areas, get that group together and establish some general aesthetic policies that we can use as a guideline for the signs for the dumpsters and the incentive things. I mean, everything we're talking about here, I think if you ask the normal business person, what's the benefit, the direct benefit for you doing that, it's probably pretty minimal. And I think we need to be cognizant of that. But at the same point in time, looking at our whole macro view in terms of what it means to the city. But I think it's important that we get some of those business people involved in this process.
Well, that committee probably needs to include some marketing and branding and other professionals as well that can help us educate on the need for this type of vision.
I think you're right when it comes to signage. I guess I wouldn't necessarily agree about dumpsters, but I definitely signage. I think that that's an important aesthetic.
Well, I think we need their input so that we can garner their
John
support.
Doe may have a perfect solution for the problem that we're not even aware of.
Okay, we can certainly do that.
I mean, for dumpsters and for hiding, covering storage as well, I think that's discussions that we need to have.
I mean, if we have 10 business people here that concur with us that this is in the best interest of the city, that has a significantly different meaning than five of us from the city hall saying we need to change things. It's just how people are going to perceive it because they're part of the process. We've seen the success of that with some of the committees that we've worked on, but I'm just not comfortable making some decisions that are going to have a direct impact on businesses without getting those business people involved in that process. That's my personal and professional approach.
I agree with that, and I would also include citizens as well, especially those who expressed concerns about
Kathy?
Yeah, I don't agree that the dumpster issue should be in it. I think that needs to be tightened up and taken care of. Obviously, you guys don't have residences on your block that have dumpsters.
Residential dumpsters is a different story.
That's what I mean. Residents and even the businesses, because I did the same thing as Terry a couple weeks ago and drove in and out and then in and out. I only counted 97 dumpsters, but I could have missed a couple. But
you were probably texting while you were driving.
I probably was.
Missed one or two.
But the signage thing, too, there's several that are empty. A lot of them, since the wind the other day, I understand that, are broken, and it does take a while to get those vinyl plates back in. But I think before we start setting down terms, if we were just to ask to clean up what you've got, some of those signs are so old you can't read them, and there's some on Main Street that way also. Just, freshen it up a little bit to get it so that it's at least somewhat visible for this year. And I don't think anybody would have a problem with that while we're forming the committee to decide how to uniformly sign our highway. Because there's some that are out there that just need some TLC, a couple of hours clipping wires or painting the post or just some minor stuff.
I would still recommend an educational opportunity where they might get a notice saying code enforcement, maybe.
We can do a letter or something, or knock on
doors. Come and talk to us at 7 o'clock at Town Hall. We're going to talk about it and learn more about it, and so that they can have a time to express and learn and get some factual information before those letters start coming in.
I would ask that we not send a letter without a visit.
Yeah, that's knock on the door.
If we don't have time to go out and visit with a business and explain our position, we're in the wrong business.
Understood.
I mean, that's my direction, and if I could enforce that from council, that's the way it would be, is that you do not just send a letter to somebody to inform them about not being in compliance. We need to go out there and have a face-to-face conversation and understand everything in terms of what's going on.
You don't even have to word it to be in non-compliance.
Right.
Just, freshen up appearances.
Who's we? Us, the council and the mayor, or who are you talking about? Staff? Who's we?
We in regards to?
To going out and visiting the individual businesses, I think, is where he's referencing.
Okay, that doesn't answer the council or the mayor or the staff?
Ooh,
all of us?
Preston, you're in charge.
Oh, I don't mind, but we ought to start a dump the dumpster campaign. No, come on,
I'm not sure I understand your point. Go ahead.
You said we, us, you and I, and
I think,
Dennis?
I think we collectively as City Hall.
Okay. Sure, I'm in.
Mr. Hamrick, you've requested to speak on this issue. Go ahead.
Thank you very much, John Hamrick, 108 Dewey Road. And you thought Hail Pet Doors was hot. Oh, my goodness. It seems to me that there's a big possibility that this could end up being as controversial. But I support what you're trying to do, and I have a suggestion for you that I hope may help things and maybe more of a short-term solution than some of the longer-term solutions that you're looking at. And that is, if you've got lemons, make lemonade. If you can get an agreement with the dumpster owners, which there's probably two, turn some of the PCC art students loose on them. Make them works of art, something that would be good to see. That might even go for some of the abandoned signage superstructure. So just to kind of thinking outside the box idea for you all to consider. Thanks.
Thank you. Any direction from the committee on this, or are we just taking information? Okay. Let's go to item number two. Item number two was actually moved to the February 22nd Vision Committee. Mm-hmm. So we'll move to item number three.
Item number three is a Fremont County Tourism Council funding request. And I think there's a couple that are speaking.
So I have Peggy Garris signed up to speak.
Well, thanks for having us again. I hope everybody got our brand new visitor guide. We're pretty excited about it. It does feature some of the new branding ideas that we had talked about.
I did not get any.
Oh,
maybe we didn't pass them.
They didn't pass them down. They got Lisa.
My fault. They made it this far.
Here you go, Lisa. Lisa, we got, you got a spare one here?
No.
Okay, we're good to go.
We are here in regards to asking for $25,000. And I believe you all have a packet. You should have a letter from our chairman. And if you could give me just a brief second, there's some council members here that I would like to introduce. We have Larry Hill from Starlight Campgrounds. We have Blaine Heckert from the Quality Inn. And we have John Miller from our Florence representative with Willie's Antiques. There's a couple that weren't able to be here, but I think it's important that you would review this. Beth and I both discussed that we really would like you as a partner. You've always been a good partner to have on our side. Beth, if you have something to add.
Yeah, thank you. I requested to speak also. I've sat on the Fremont County Tourism Council almost 10 years. I've been vice chair, treasurer, I know that you guys have had a lot of questions and had a lot of questions answered already. But I think one of the main points that should be made as far as the Fremont County Tourism Council is that we're all a bunch of volunteers who devote a lot of time to presenting a product that brings people to our area. And I've always felt that one of the biggest values that the Fremont County Tourism Council offers to the Royal Gorge region is the fact that we represent the entire region. And we have spent countless hours working on branding programs and marketing programs and going through being presented with all kinds of different information of how to market areas. We've developed the visitor's guide, which we do every year, which is an excellent piece of advertising that also has a lot of good information about the area. We print 120,000 of these, distribute them throughout the state, mail them out through fulfillment. We also have developed an excellent website that you know, when I first came on, well, it actually, we barely even had websites when I first got on the council, but we've developed into an interactive website program with videos on it and pictures. He sends out email blasts. We communicate with people. We have programs where we incentivize people to bring in, you know, where we send out a basket of things so that people can come into there and they're awarded through a sweepstakes. And you know, we've done a bunch of programs to figuring out what is the most identifiable, the phrase that brings the people to this area. And we're all proud that we live in Fremont County, and we're all proud that we are live in Canyon City or in Florence and Penrose. But if you add the item that people recognize is Royal Gorge, and that's why we chose the Royal Gorge region to represent the entire area. And by forming a unified group that's under the auspice of the lodging tax, administration of the lodging tax, we actually can, there's a synergy there. We can represent Penrose and Florence and Western Fremont County and the entire area, along with Canyon City, of which Canyon City is our biggest partner. And we can bring everybody together, all the different marketing entities and all the different activities that we have here. And because of that, we have the ability to take a small amount of money and have a really interactive program that allows, I think it's the biggest bang for the buck. And if we each try to do that, if each entity tries to do it separately, it's not nearly as valuable as if we have one main entity that represents the entire area. So, and that's why I feel that by you guys giving us the $25,000, we have utilized that $25,000 to the maximum amount, with allowing us to get much more social and internet media, and really develop some real big programs. Because I know you guys, you know, every time I see people coming down from Skyline Drive and stopping at Main Street, and I'm, you know, walking back and forth across there all day, every single day, I see everybody looking down at their phones. And you know what they're doing? They're sitting places to eat in Canyon City, places to go in Canyon City, things to do in Fremont County, things to do in the Royal Gorge region. That was developed by the Fremont County Tourism Council. In the same way with the website, that was all that is developed by the Fremont County Tourism Council through VistaWorks. And so I just think that, and that's what your $25,000 has helped to support. So thank you.
Mr. Chair. We all know what your organization brings to our entire community. And I think that everybody will agree with me. The problem that we or I have with this is that we're a major contributor. Who else writes a check each month out of Florence, Fremont County, and the people that also benefit from this? Who else brings money to the table on a yearly basis to help perpetuate this wonderful thing, very productive thing that you folks do?
Well, and I understand that you're concerned about that, but I think you also have to understand that, well, Fremont County, of course, administers the whole thing, and they provide representatives, and their accounting department takes care of all the invoicing and the bills and gathering all the taxes, and so that is a big part of it. We actually, you couldn't even happen without the Fremont County doing that. But, and I, you know, Florence is a much smaller entity than Canyon City, and Penrose is even smaller than that. And I mean, you know, when we originally came up with the concept of putting out an RFP for somebody to actually do the work for Fremont County Tourism Council, because before we actually brought in an entity to do the executive work for us, we didn't get a whole lot done. In fact, it wasn't a very effective organization at all. And so originally the idea was to come up and we put out an RFP. And the only one that came forward to offer their services was originally the Canyon City Chamber of Commerce. And we had a, you know, organization with them, and that worked for a while. And then when that sort of, then the next time we came up to RFP, VistaWorks came forward. And so, I mean, that's where some of our lodging tax money goes, is to actually pay them to administer that. But we get a lot of money for our usage. And I'm sorry, Florence is a great town. It's a busy town. But they do not have the resources. I mean, their chamber is basically non-existent. They don't. You know, and so, I mean, and they have contributed things, but.
Something we've talked about before, and this is not the first rodeo with this, is do it on a population-based amount. Everybody contribute what they can based on their population and their budget, what they can afford to do. It's just, I mean, if they can only afford $5,000 a year, or they can afford $2,000 a year, at least somebody else, another community within our area, is contributing cold hall dollars to help perpetuate what you folks are doing, and most of you on a volunteer basis.
Well, and so, Mark,
it's what we've been asking for 2 years.
I know. And, you know, originally, when a lot of this stuff was originally done with the Tourism Council, Florence and Penrose didn't even have any representatives at all. Penrose still doesn't. And they also, want to be politically correct here, but, you know, Canyon City derives benefit from the Royal Gorge Bridge, a large
amount. That's because we own it, yeah.
Right. And so everybody else in the county then
derives benefits from it, too.
Well, they don't actually feel that way.
But they do.
Yeah, I know, but I'm
it's a major attraction that brings people in from everywhere.
Right.
Help us out,
Mark,
folks.
Mark, if you let me address this. I've been on the council 5 years, and I've sat in meetings and taking notes for many meetings before that. Canyon City traditionally gave several thousand dollars to someone to advertise, whether it was directly to the chamber or to, and it was decided that we already have a vehicle with professionals that pretty much know what they're doing because we do this for our own business. So if you're going to spend money on advertising, which I think the city really does need to do, we're a perfect vehicle to put any advertising dollars you want into our coffers. That's.
But other people benefit from it, and they need to advertise their businesses too. I'm sorry. It's just something that I personally don't understand. Everybody benefits from it, and you guys come to us, which is, it's happened for a lot of years, which is a wonderful thing, and it's worked. But for a number of years, I know people are saying, come on, guys, Florence, Fremont County, everybody, come on out. Bring some money to the table. We know the money's well spent. We know it's good to go. It's benefiting everybody in Fremont County and surrounding counties. It's just more of a, with it, it's just like somebody else helped contribute to this on whatever cost you, or whatever you can afford, whatever's in your budget, just do it fairly. A majority of the 8% is generated within Canyon City because of the number of hotels. And it's also good that Fremont County, you know, does the bookkeeping and this and that. But somebody bring some cash to the table and show that they're interested in it and that it's benefiting their communities, because it is. We understand that, and we have for a number of years. But somebody else bring some money to the table too. I'm sorry. I apologize for where I stand, but it's where I stand.
You don't need to apologize. Yeah, I mean, these are things we can Dennis, take back to the council.
Yeah, I was just thinking, you know, I hear what Mark's saying, but the more I think about it, the less I really get hung up on what Florence and Penrose and the county contribute to this. I guess, primarily because I would say almost certainly when it comes to revenue generated as a result of tourism, Canyon City is by far the huge winner, simply because it's the biggest city and we have all the, I have, practically speaking, we've got all the hotels and we have a majority of the restaurants, although Florence has a good selection of high-quality restaurants. But, I'm less hung up on that. You know, Beth, what's the budget this year before you get to anything that Canyon City might contribute? What's the FCPC budget for 2017? Off the top of your head, if you know.
Give me a second. I need to grab some figures.
About 160,000.
Okay. Yeah. I'm thinking it's around 180,000, and that was before, yeah, any grants or anything. It's about that. Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's all. Yeah. I mean that's Florence only has, the only hotel that Florence has is a Super 8, and then the Riviera Inn, and I think that's 10 rooms, and everything else is pretty much, and then what is it?
Yeah. It's a. Did you say the budget is 80,000 or
170,000? So 170,000 is what we basically collected in lodging tax dollars last year. The county collected in lodging tax dollars.
Well, actually, okay, that includes 25,000.
What I read, if this is correct, 2/3 of that is mostly conventional marketing, which is, you know, the print pieces and that sort of stuff. And then 1/3, roughly, is the more modern digital approach, which primarily includes social media and then AdWords. And I'm convinced that social media, if we're putting money into marketing, social media is, I think, where it needs to go. Simply, just what you were saying, is when you see people walking around with their heads in their, with their faces in their phones, they're looking up what to do and where to go and what to eat, and, you know, all those sorts of things. Do you, off the top of your head, do you have any idea what, out of our budget, how much of that goes to VistaWorks and how much goes to actual marketing?
Well, actually, yeah, so the money for, like, when the visitor's guide that we produce, we don't pay to have that printed, and we don't pay for the production of the guide. That's all paid for by the advertising that is in here by every entity in the whole Royal Gorge region, including outside of the, in the Pikes Peak and Cripple Creek. So that this piece is it, the only thing that we have to pay for the visitor's guide is the certified distribution. Other than that, everything, right. That's the only thing we have to pay for out of the, out of our budget, okay? And then we
need to pay for fulfillment.
And then fulfillment, which is actually mailing the pieces to people who request them, which is the most effective form of advertising that there is. But other than that, the advertising sold in the visitor's guide pays for the visitor's guide. Then the 25,000 that I think we've gotten for the last 2 years and originally started, originally with the whole thing came up after the fire, goes all towards the social media, and it's primarily used for things like pay-per-view, the clicks, you know, keeping track of things, keeping our website up, keeping up on the things. And actually, in the county last year, gave us some additional money for its fulfillment. And then we also get the grant from the Colorado Tourism Association, and that's the only thing we can use that grant for is also marketing. So almost all of our money goes directly to marketing, and VistaWorks is paid to be the executive for the administration of the Fremont County, but Brian does an excellent job of coming down, and actually he owns a business. He moved his office down here to Canyon City, pays lease and employs people in Canyon City so he could be a part of Canyon City through and he actually has other clients down here too.
Yeah, that's I guess where I'm going here is I think Canyon City is kind of thinking about maybe looking at a longer term strategy and maybe a more significant marketing budget and where that would come from is hopefully to get some kind of a cooperative activity between the major tourist attraction and so primarily, be real simple, that would be train, the bridge, and rafting. You know, those are probably the big three around here. And get some kind of a cooperative thing going. I guess my inclination until that happens is to continue to contribute to the FCTC. I don't know if I would be in at the 25,000 level, but I would be comfortable saying that we would dedicate a bigger number, but I know it was split 50-50 between social media and AdWords. AdWords campaigns tend to be really, really expensive. Social media tends to be very inexpensive, especially when you compare it to the AdWords campaigns. And I guess my recommendation or inclination would say that the city contribute $15,000 to FCTC to be specifically and entirely dedicated to social media.
So. Thanks, Dennis. Ashley?
Yeah.
Beth, have you officially gone to City of Florence or to the county to present this to them?
No.
Have you gone to City Council Florence or any of the other entities within Fremont County
No.
or gone to the county?
I don't
county?
Think so. No, I don't. No. And Fremont County,
I'm pretty sure we know what the answer would be, though, if they did.
Well, that may be true. I don't know.
Issues concerning equal financing.
Mr. Mayor?
Well, I have detected for some time a real uncomfortableness from council for this. I think you got a great product, don't get me wrong. But I also have a little problem in that I know years ago other entities bid on this. I don't know if that's appropriate or not, whether you want to even consider it. We do that with a lot of other things. Whether that is for Dennis saying suggestion that we do it for social media, there's other possible people in town that might not, I don't know.
I'm not sure what you're saying.
Well, you're asking for $25,000 essentially to do social media and everything. Are there other companies? Maybe the local newspaper does that. They do mine for my company, and it's all social media and internet advertising, and I think they do a good job. I don't know if there's any, and maybe there isn't. I don't know. I'm not saying this is a good product.
We put this out, and they all came and bid on it. The RFPs, we've put out the RFPs for this, what VistaWorks does now every 3 years. And actually, last time, no one came and bid
Never
on
bid.
It, including the Daily
Record.
VistaWorks
does a very fine job. VistaWorks is a really
I'm not debating that. I just didn't know if we kind of...
This is administration of lodging tax dollars, which was, it's a ballot issue. So it has, put it out, and last time, nobody came. And the first time when we put it out, when the chamber originally did it, I don't think anybody else came to look at
it. I just wondered, because we do that on a lot of items where we're put on RFP, and
right.
I don't know if the city does that, or if...
Yeah, we put out the RFP, and that's, yeah. You know, I think that, one of the things as a business owner and a person who's asked about advertising possibilities all the time, well, one thing is, yes, true. In fact, this is the only print advertising I do is the ad in this visitor's guide because it's so reasonable. I do not do any more print advertising. In fact, I hardly pay for advertising at all anymore because I rely on TripAdvisor to bring people.
Right.
And so when you're looking at social media, it's a great idea to think about everybody developing their own social media. You know, you guys have a website, and the county has a website, and Florence has a website. But guess what? When I'm looking online at things, if I'm not here, and I'm going to go, and I'm going to say, Royal Gorge, because I don't know Canyon City, and I don't know Fremont County, and there's lots of Fremont counties, or I might even put Canyon City in, but. If you have somebody who's administering your website and building your social media, what they're doing is they're getting the name out. And the more you get the name out, then the higher up you stay on when you go to look at the thing. And so if everybody has their own site, it's actually becomes real problematic because I happen to know that when Fremont County just was looking at developing their website and you guys were looking to develop your website, there's a company that comes around and they say, hey, we want you to place an ad on the front of our website and we want you to help the city do their website or Fremont County do their website and we only want to charge you this much money. And, you know, the first time they came through about 6 years ago, it was like, oh, well, this is interesting. Well, it wasn't very effective, and it was actually for the city of Canyon City, and it never really happened. And they've come two times since then, and all of us who originally had advertised with them or took that spot on their front page button idea, none of us will deal with them anymore. And every time that somebody comes up with a different marketing plan, guess who they come to support that marketing plan? It's all of us businesses who work really hard to bring people to this area. Well, we can't support that. You know, I just can't support that anymore. So I guess what I'm saying is, if you guys don't feel that it's worth it, it's just, by approving the $25,000, if you guys were to approve that, we will be able to continue making highly effective, strategic, trackable investments in social media. Without it, we'll be forced to reduce expenditures. And that means the website in general will go down across the board, and those little billboards that we have, those videos on the 16th Street Strip Mall that bring people down here now, they'll disappear. That's the kind of stuff that we've spent this money on. So that's, That's your guys' decision. I also, just one other thing, I happened to talk to several of the rafting companies and some of the other people that you guys are thinking of, and they said, you know, they're not gonna join up. They already spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on advertising. You know, they don't need to spend more money. You know, they put their ads in here and they do their own marketing. So, you know, we all reach a limit of how much we can spend on marketing.
And we also have a, go ahead.
I was just gonna ask Beth, what's the timeline? You were gonna be pursuing a different type of lodging tax that would help supplement your funds potentially so it could be self-sufficient. What's the timeline on pursuing that?
Well, we just formed a committee to look into it. And that, yeah, the additional marketing tax, the marketing district, which, yeah.
Ultimate goal is to be independent and self-sufficient and get a competitive fund.
Right,
and
right.
A lot of the statistics that are in this document, I went to the governor's tourism convention and I was there and saw firsthand the importance of marketing money. And yes, we do need to have a bigger budget, absolutely. But there also was a big factual presentation is if you build up this momentum towards getting certain clients into your business, for us it's Canyon City or the Royal Gorge, and then it is a huge loss when you cut that and you can't get those customers back again. And so there is a little bit of a concern about cutting the funding, but maybe looking to the future of having your self-sufficiency or going forward with our plan of finding alternative fundings to get a legitimate program that's in the hundreds of thousands of dollars potentially. But to just to cut it cold until we get to that point, that could be detrimental. That's a little bit of a concern for me.
I have a couple of questions. If I can remember what they were. One, you had said trackable marketing. Do we have some actual figures from that?
Yeah, every month that Brian presents us with all the tracks of all the marketing that he has, yeah.
And that's the information that he presented the last time?
Well, that was, I think maybe the first time he presented it, because, yeah, but that, no, it is all trackable. And it's also, I mean, without fail, I know that every single bit of the money that you guys, because we invoiced for every time that we spent any money, and all of it was only spent on social media and internet marketing and or ways to get, you know, the other side of when you do any kind of advertising that's print or board or stuff is to get the website out there. That's, you know, that's what you're doing.
Okay, then I guess my other question is more organizational, or I'm going to say fundamental structure-wise. I find it odd that we seem to be the major contributor in terms of cash dollars, because the vast majority of your budget or significant portion of your budget comes from tax revenues, as I understand it, right?
All of it. Yeah, all of it except for the grant and then your money.
We seem to be the one entity that's contributing additional dollars, but I could be wrong, but it seems to me like we don't have a voice on the board, if it's a board.
Yes, you do. Kathleen's there every week, every meeting. There's always been an appointed city representative.
According to the open meeting laws, I cannot.
Are you avoiding? Are you avoiding?
No, I'm not voting. I'm ex officio. I can spout ideas, but most of the time.
Why is that?
The bylaws of the Fremont County Tourism Council is composed of seven people who are in the tourism industry for the administration of the lodging tax dollars, with ex officios from the chamber, the city of Florence, and the city of Canyon City, and who else is in FEDC. Anyone's welcome to come. They're always open meetings. We have a lot of interaction, and also 5% of. A minimum of 5% by the bylaws, a minimum of 5% of the total amount of lodging tax dollars received by the Fremont County Tourism has to be given back to fund community organizations for marketing their different festivals and so that money is every year, like we just distributed $9,250 back to the community for the marketing of community events throughout, and we always make sure that there's however many requests we get, we try to fund everybody, and we always make sure that Florence has one representative, Penrose has some, and then the Canyon City and other any anybody who wants to come. And those monies has to be shown, proved to bring heads in beds for specifically lodging tax dollars. And you know, there's also the huge contribution of organizations such as FAR, which we give to money every year, or the Whitewater Festival, which we give money to every year, because they bring a significant amount of heads in beds for multiple night stays. I told this anecdote to the Fremont County Tourism Board just the other day, that this last weekend and this weekend, I probably had well over 100 people both days at the restaurant who came down, and one day they went biking, and the next day they went climbing. One day they went skiing, and the next day they went climbing. They went biking, they went climbing. And that's all because of this and the website. That's what brings those people down here from the Front Range for multiple night stays.
So. Okay, we'll try to wrap this up. I personally have a complication with the fact that we're contributing $25,000 and we have no vote, and I realize it's a bylaw, but that doesn't make any sense to me. So can we come to any kind of a consensus in terms of moving forward or not?
How much of the money did you use last year from the 25?
I think we used all of it last year.
I spoke to VistaWorks, and he spent 100% of it on digital advertising.
Well, it was spent on digital, but was it all spent? Because on the financials I got Tuesday morning, it still showed a balance.
He spent every single penny of it, but at VistaWorks.
Oh.
But whether or not the Tourism Council turned in those invoices to the city yet, that's up to you.
Yeah, they might not have been paid yet.
I think what he said was 100% of what they've asked for, they've been paid, but there's still a balance on your financials.
A positive balance,
like $9,500.
A positive balance?
Yeah, that they have not used from last year. And I know there is a balance on their financials this year. What did you guys do before you came to the city? What did you do for that money? I mean, where did you go for it?
We didn't have any. We just didn't have any, and there was very little, you know, marketing done for the website.
Right. It started.
You know,
with
that was, you know.
So you just started the website.
Right. A number of years ago, we spent $25,000 of the lodging tax dollars for a branding campaign and a logo and everything, and we paid for that, and it was developed, and then they presented it to us, and they said, okay, well, here's your logo and here's your branding. Now you guys have to come up with some money to market it. Well, we didn't have any money, so that's it. That's as far as it ever went.
And this was 2 years ago.
No, that was about five years ago. Oh, okay. Six or 7 years ago.
Okay.
Dennis,
yeah.
You got a suggestion? Dennis.
Yeah.
Have you got a? What's your suggestion here?
Well, you know what? Actually, listening to Beth, she really is persuasive, and then. The comment that Ashley was making about backing away from tourism marketing is really has a devastating effect on tourism in general. You know, honestly, until we come up with a better plan, I guess after considering everything, I would reconsider and say I would support the entire $25,000 and spent on digital marketing, and primarily I would like to see it spent on social media. But I think it's a mistake to pull away until you have something to fill the gap.
So is it fair for us to start out with saying that we'll at least consider the $25,000 that would be used exclusively for social media? Can we come to a consensus on that?
I think so. And I think also with us in supporting you guys and going forward with your alternative funding to become self-sufficient, and for us moving forward with our plans as well to try and find a genuine marketing plan.
Yeah, and understanding that, you know, we're all looking at different things, and things could be different next year, but I don't know.
Do we have it in the budget since they weren't involved in the original funding? Do we have that in the budget?
No, we didn't put it in the budget.
It's not in the budget.
No.
contingent upon approval and finding the money in the budget, where would we stand?
I would support the $25,000 this year. What I would really, and it's because of Dennis' comments, Ashley's comments, it's making good sense. But next year, when it comes in front of us, number one, it needs to be when everybody else does, please, because it just makes it so we don't have to go back and refigure our budget. The second thing that I would like to see done, and you know what's coming, is I'd like to see Florence, Fremont County, and perhaps even the Royal Gore Bridge presented with something to try to fill some of this gap. And tell me if that's a bad idea, if it's something that's already been done, it hasn't been talked about.
Well, just so you know, yeah, the Royal Gorge Bridge is, I don't think you guys know how much money, I mean, they actually step up and meet a lot of the 50% of for their marketing, you know, if we need to, for a campaign, you know, say, well, you know, we'll, they'll match, they've matched thousands of dollars that they contribute to the
And that's never been brought up, it's never been made.
And then also the county last year contributed thousands of dollars towards additional fulfillment
the
and money.
The bridge spends $759,000 last year in marketing because it's required by the city's agreement with them. They're required to spend 6% of their gross revenue.
Okay.
That's not.
Then I'm all wet there because I didn't.
That's
know.
A city
but
requirement.
But it's like their benefit of funding too, and obviously they're doing their part.
I would like to address something too. We consider you guys a good and great partner. And one of the things we're doing that hasn't been brought up, I am now sitting on the committee. We really don't want to come hat in hand here either. But we are very dead serious about forming a marketing district, and we need the council's help with this when we go to do this, because it has to go on ballot, and it can go on ballot in 2017 or it can go on ballot 2018. We are asking other businesses to join us with our little council. There's three of us on the committee, and you know, we want that budget that Alamosa and Salida have. We want that $500,000 budget, and we think we can spend it better and wiser than they can, but we really need the city's help in getting this, I guess, getting it through, because I guess there are certain things that, and we're gonna need Florence's help, we're gonna need everybody's help, and that way we won't have to ask for extra monies. We feel like we'll be ahead of the game, so we're being proactive.
Just go to them. Present it to them, please.
We will.
Please.
And we do want to make sure you know that we appreciate all that you guys
My
do.
Goodness,
and,
yes.
And it is important to us. We value it greatly. And if you feel a little bit of heat, it's just because we feel an incredible need to have accountability to the taxpayer money, and that we've asked this type of details and questions and numbers and statistics from all of the groups that we are giving money to now. And that, I agree with Mark, that let's have this conversation again during the actual time period where we're forming our budget.
I'm inclined to be in favor, but I'm going to reiterate that I believe that there needs to be discussion on your board in terms of your rules that do not allow a member of council to be a voting member.
Mr. Mayor?
I think it's a good program. I would support it. Yep.
Kathy?
I would support it for one more year with the stipulation that next year, of course, they come in when all of the other nonprofits come in, and the fact that we have some proof that they have gone to other entities also.
Makes sense?
Yes, thank you.
Jim, I just want to make sure you said that you would go ahead and support it, and then also far as them amending their bylaws to allow a voting member from the
we
city.
Need, yeah. We need some information back for next year. When we talk next year, the fact that we're going to have a voting voice on your board is going to be significant as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, we do have a new committee form to go over the bylaws.
So, I mean, if they're bylaws, they can be changed.
Yeah, yep. It's the county's authority to revise the bylaws. We've asked them to do that. Unfortunately, they haven't. But the county commission can change that requirement in weeks.
Okay. So we're going to recommend for consent agenda. Dennis, you good?
Yes, I am.
I think that's also pending finding the funding as well, too. I mean,
right.
It's kind of important.
Yeah. That'll be Harry's magic.
Yeah, we got to find the money.
We have a lot on our list. Stipends.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Are we still allowed to eat there?
Any other council information update?
Beth?
Dennis is on there.
Are we still allowed to eat there?
Dennis, you got any more information?
No, I just said thank you to Beth and Peggy.
Okay, no other business. We're adjourned at 5:20.